confuse the deaths of these two stars. It just, it doesn't make sense, does it? I mean, I'll admit that World War II suffered many blackouts, not just on the streets, but on news as well. There were plenty of official cover-ups as well. To this day, for example, nobody knows what happened to the most famous bandleader the world's ever known, and that was American bandleader Glenn Miller. Cover-ups encouraged the lunatic fringe to let their imaginations run riot. He died in a prostitute's bed in somewhere in Berlin, or the British bombermen were frightened to tell the Americans. I've even seen an official American hospital document claiming that the death of Alton Glenn Miller took place in Ohio in December of 1945. And then we mustn't forget the cover-up on Britain's top wartime singer, Mr. Begin the Begin himself, an officer in the Royal Navy, Chick Henderson. He died, it was claimed, officially, and I've got his padre's letter saying so. He was killed by a piece of shrapnel from a British AK-AK gun. My research proved that he was shot by a German Air Force gunner who discovered the secret hideout of hundreds of Royal Navy officers. Now, with the killing of Ken Snakehips Johnson, an entire confidential file went missing. Went missing in transit, nobody knows. It was never found, and it never will be found. Let me tell you that for certain. Now, Ken Johnson was nicknamed Snakehips because he was a brilliant dancer. You could say he was almost an acrobatic dancer, a real swinger, a hip swinger. It's hardly surprising that he harboured an ambition to be a swing band leader. Lots of young people did, and still do, want to be in the dance business, even though they don't dance like they used to anymore. Gradually, much to his parents' annoyance, I would suspect, medicine and law were gradually pushed to one side, and he tried to assemble a swing band. "He doesn't stand a chance," said the cynical British musicians. Who's he think he is coming over here and telling us what to do and how to play? And anyhow, a swing band, had no chance at all. Look at the hit parade, man. It's filled with schmaltz and novelty songs, things like, oh, have a listen to this.
"Horsey, horsey, don't you stop. Just let your feet go clippity-clop. Your tail goes swish and the wheels go round. Giddy-up, we're homeward bound. Horsey, horsey, on your way. We've done the journey many a day. Your tail goes swish and the wheels go round. Giddy-up, we're homeward bound. We ain't in the hustle.
Down in the meadow in the itty-bitty pool swam three giddy fishies and a mama fishy too. Swim, said the mama fishy, swim if you can. And they swam all over the dam. Boop, boop, diddum, da-dum, wa-dum, choo. Boop, boop, diddum, da-dum, wa-dum, choo. Boop, boop, diddum, da-dum, wa-dum, choo. And they fam all over the dam.
Tippy-tippy-tin, tippy-tin.
Picture hat that your mommy wore. living in a world that you never saw. My little lady made me live. What a pair of shoes for two tiny feet. What a pair of gloves the fingers don't meet. Posing in a glass, your joy is complete. My little lady made believe in your little arms.
Fancy a hit parade full of itty bitty poos and tippy tippy tins and whistles and little girls dressed up in their mammy's clothes. I don't know. Ken, I must say this, he had the guts and the spirit of a missionary. He was determined not just to form a swing band and make it pay. He committed himself to forming the best swing and dance band Britain had ever seen. And finally, he succeeded where all the others had failed, but only for a few brief months. So, how is it that his name is virtually unknown today, except to the dedicated few who remember him? Or his few records, or some of those latter-day collectors of rhythmic knowledge and music memorabilia. Wartime cover-ups helped to bury the truths surrounding his death. I mean, he only made 8 gramophone records. That's 16 titles in all, and the masters and the metalwork of all but 2 of them were destroyed years and years and years ago. So, can the world ever know the true sound of Britain's greatest dance band leader and musical achiever? Can they ever sort of imagine the true sound from old scratchy records playing at 78 revs per minute and sounding like this? Well, by the time this program ends, and with the aid of state-of-the-art technology, you will know, because I'm going to take you back in time to those dangerous days to hear what the actual band sounded like. Clearer than it was ever heard on the radio or on any 78 RPM gramophone records. I'd like to tell you a bit about the band first, because I think it's vitally important. Ken Johnson's first band, it actually got a 6-week trial engagement at the old Florida Club. Well, in those days, black or coloured musicians, as they were always referred to, were often regarded with a form of mistrust by upper-class diners. Honestly, that's true. But a band full of them, well, that had never happened in Britain before. And they got a job in a well-heeled clientele club. That aroused a lot of curiosity. Now, the band needed experience, so it undertook stage work as well as its regular late-night work at the club. And you know, the nights at the club didn't start in the morning. It wasn't a nightclub, it was a morning club. The band started playing at 2 o'clock in the morning. And a senior BBC music producer, Leslie Perrone, gave them a broadcast. He was very impressed with them. But you know, again, this is where the bigotry and the bias crept in. A snotty reviewer in Radio Review, which was a musical weekly paper, he had this to say about that first broadcast. He said, "This band claims to be the only regular coloured combination in the country. I dare say it is. Surprising as it may seem, it's almost impossible to form an all-coloured band as there are so few coloured musicians in England. And anyhow, only English Negroes are allowed to work here. This broadcast must be written off as another of the all-too-many failures. The band, well, it just wasn't good enough. It had a veneer of that sense of style and rhythm inherent in all Negroes. These boys are from Trinidad, British Guiana, and Barbados. The intonation of the saxophones, and particularly the singer, was distressingly bad." Now, that was just typical of the bigotry suffered by Ken Johnson and his band.
sing a roundup song as you ride along.
Was the band Ken Snakehips Johnson and his West Indian Dance Orchestra, as you've never heard it before. And the singer there, that's the one that the reviewer referred to as being distressingly bad. But of course, that was just bigotry and a very, very biased, racially biased reporter there. I wonder if he could play an instrument. I doubt it very much. Anyhow, what I can tell you for definite is the BBC's music producer, Leslie, didn't see it the way the reviewer saw it. He thought this band is great. And his belief in the band was backed up by listeners' letters and telephone calls. There weren't many people ringing the BBC in those days. In fact, I wish they wouldn't do it these days. But there we are. Phone-ins aren't my idea of journalism, but that's just my own opinion. Leslie Perrone gave them many more broadcasts. Lots of broadcasts. Even so, some musicians left the band. I think that had something to do with money and contracts that had been made with some of them in the very beginning. And the result was that Ken had to send back home to British Guiana to recruit more musicians. He got them as well, and they were delighted at the opportunity of coming over to Britain and joining a new band. They too were swingers, you see. And it was late in 1939, in fact, just after Britain declared war on Germany, that he got the best news he'd ever had. He got a literal prize of gold. He and his band were offered the residency at the famous Café de Paris. Some of the greatest bands ever seen in this country had played there. Obviously, the manager of that famous night spot realised that Ken Snakehips Johnson was just what they needed. It was actually a magnificent, expensive supper club, patronised by the rich, the very rich, and royalty. And as it was situated under a cinema in the West End of London, the manager got the idea, hey, you know, people have been building air raid shelters for this war. This is the biggest air raid shelter in town. So it's got to be the safest night spot, the safest restaurant in London. And he billed it as that. But sadly, time was to show it wasn't. Right. I want you to imagine now that we've got a time warp machine into which we can all go and sit comfortably, program it and go back in time to anywhere we want, except where we want to go today is back in time to, say, March of 1941. And I want to take you to the Café de Paris, where Ken Snakehips Johnson and his band will be playing. It's a rare opportunity to hear this band as no one has ever heard it before, crystal clear and in the exciting atmosphere of the Café de Paris. I know some of those old 78s said, Ken Snakehips Johnson and his West Indian Orchestra from the Café de Paris in London. They were never in there for making records. That's just one of those little illusions that record companies got up to in those days. But please try and find a chair where you can relax, take the telephone off the hook and sellotape the door knocker to the door. I just want you to sit down, relax completely, and then I'll take you away on a very exciting trip. And here we are in London. Oh dear, there's the air raid siren. Well, we've got nothing to worry about, because where I'm taking you, the Café de Paris, it's described as the safest restaurant in London, the safest night spot. And at the very beginning of the war, everything closed down, but the Café de Paris reopened very quickly, and it's become a very popular place. I'll tell you where we are now. We're actually just outside the Rialto Cinema, and then there's Lion's Corner House, even in the blackout. We're in Coventry Street in Piccadilly. Now, the doorway into the Café de Paris doesn't look much at all, and you wouldn't imagine that it led you to underneath the cinema floor, but it does, like a big air raid shelter, and that's why they've got that note. It's the safest night spot in town. So we'll just go through the little door here, and there are quite a few people going in there, quite well-heeled as well. So let's just go with them and pretend we've got money too, okay? Now, as we've stepped down from the entrance there, we can now look ahead, and there's a sort of gallery, quite a widish gallery, oval-shaped, going right around the club. And down there is the floor, and there are a lot of people in. You can hear them, their feet going along the floor there, dancing. Not much room for dancing. But let's go down the staircase. It goes to left or right, but both bring you down onto the dance floor itself. And snuggled between the staircases, the left and the right, the band is sitting there, all squashed together. The vocalist now is just getting up to the microphone. So let's go down the stairs and have a look. It's Don Johnson who's singing. That's Ken's brother.
Give me my ranch and my cattle from the great cities rattle. Give me a big herd to battle. I just love herd and cattle. I love the Rancho Grande. The rancho's fine and dandy. Wherein my saddle swinging, you'll always hear me singing. You'll always hear me singing. Give me the wide open spaces. It's just where I know my places. I love the rodeo dearly. I love the big roundup yearly.
Rancho Grande, get along, baby, will you get along?
Now the band were chanting, come along, Davy Williams. That's him playing the tenor saxophone. Dave Wilkins taking the trumpet solo there.
Thank you.
And a good round of applause. Okay, it's a little bit discreet, but there's time for them to warm up yet. Don Johnson took the vocal air, as I mentioned, and the band featured there Dave Wilkins, who was playing lead trumpet. And the other fellow, a great tenor sax player there, he's just one of the best in London. David Williams is his name, known as Baba. Don't ask me why, I don't know. But everybody enjoying themselves and looking expectantly at bandleader Ken Snakehips. John Ridey's giving the signal. Admit, I like the way they played Tuxedo Junction. It's a little faster than the original version. Erskine Hawkins and lots of other people besides, but that's the way it should be played. Now, already that band proves to me, at any rate, that it's as good as anything in Britain in the year 1941, and I would say it's a long way ahead. Now, Ken Snakehips Johnson actually has a lot of friends in the music business. Okay, he's got jealous rivals, people who say all sorts of things, but they've always done that, haven't they? But he's very good friends with Al Boley. Now, there we are. That's the second time he's cropped up in the program tonight. Al Boley and Ken are very great friends. In fact, when Al Boley isn't working, and currently he's in Variety, teamed up with Jimmy Messini. They go around singing duets. Not many people are they're not fond of that act at all. They prefer Al on his own. But I can tell you, when Al is not working, you'll find him here. Sometimes he'll come in after he's been working as well, and I've got great news for you. I've just heard that he's here tonight. And he is! He's coming out now! Wow, wait till the crowd see this. Yes, he's talking now to Ken Snakehips Johnson, and it's fairly obvious he's going to sing. Yes, he's going up to the microphone, and he's brought with him two girls. I'll find out who the girls are whilst they're singing together. What a reception and what a reaction. Again, the crowd are just clamouring for him. But I suppose that's what gave rise to people thinking that both Ken Johnson and Al Bowley met their early demise here in this very place. That's not true, though. Let's have a look at some of the musicians here. Davy Wilkins there on lead trumpet. He was taking the solos there, usually does. Second trumpeter, Leslie Jiver Hutchinson. And Jack Cusker make up the three there. In the reed section, Carl Barito, brilliant clarinet player, Bertie King, and George Roberts, and David Williams. That's the man we've been hearing already. You can pick him out. You know, as soon as a man gets playing and he takes his solo, no doubt about it. Trombone player tonight is Freddie Butt, and at the piano, the regular pianist, York D'Souza. Guitarist is Joe Denise, and Ernie Stevens, I think that is, on the double bass. The vocalist, Don Johnson, of course, and the drummer is called Tommy Wilson. And Ken is now beckoning to the boys.
its head. Please remember this. I fell in love for the last time with a first kiss.
Better be getting back to the studio. Been absolutely fabulous. Let's get back up the staircase, take the left or take the right, whichever you want, and then you'll find when we get to the top, we'll take our last look down at this big oval-shaped night spot with glass mirrors virtually all the way around. It makes the place look twice as big, you know, but it's really something. And we're at the top of the stairs now. Let's just look back down, take one last fun look down at a legendary place with an amazing band leader who has hit the very top. But before the fact can sink in, he'll be gone. Well, there, for the very first time, we've been able to hear what can only be described as the best British dance band ever, in London or anywhere else in Britain at that particular time. And, of course, in a quality and fidelity unheard of at the time. Other British dance bands, of course, had been decimated by conscription, the call-up of musicians. And Lou Stone, a top British band leader, told me that he had to make do with third-grade musicians because he couldn't get quality ones that had been called up. But the work, this was also sad, the work of new arrangers was at an absolute standstill. But Ken Johnson had the advantage of two great arrangers in his own band. Yep, Davy Wilkins was a brilliant arranger. So was Carl Barreto, the clarinetist. He could write down an arrangement as quickly as he could hear it on an American record, for example. He could score that arrangement, they could be playing it in minutes. I'll tell you another man, George Evans, the great London band leader who spent so much time in Tyneside at the Oxford Galleries ballroom. He arranged one of those Shakespearean numbers, and I knew George personally. George told me that, in his opinion, Ken Snakehips Johnson and his band became the greatest band, but because of his sad death, it hadn't had time to sink in, and that's what everybody seems to say. I'll tell you another great arranger that he had, an American who was appearing in London. His name was Adrian de Haas, and he actually wrote and arranged this piece for Ken Johnson personally. It even included Johnson's name in the title, Snakehips Swing. Thank you. Snakehips Swing, written and arranged especially for Ken Snakehips Johnson by Adrian de Haas, an American who was a great admirer of the band. Well, what went wrong that a man reached the very top of his profession in such a short while and yet today is virtually forgotten except by fans and connoisseurs? What would have happened if he'd lived? Well, I've got a good idea, but we can only theorise. The sad thing was, and this is the irony of it, that night spot was described as the safest in London, for reasons which I've mentioned. There was a big cinema above it, so even if a bomb hit the cinema, one would have thought it would have damaged the cinema, but couldn't have done any damage to the nightclub situated beneath it. But on the 8th of March in 1941... the band was really holding down that prestigious and lucrative spot at the Café de Paris nightclub. There was a lot of influential people in that night. There was a buzz of excitement. But all that was to end, absolutely and totally. Leslie Driver Hutchinson, a trumpeter with the band, tells what happened.
Mr. Ken came in a hurry and he said, "Man, it's terrible out there. Just terrible." Ken was a really charming guy to work with. Very happy, happy-go-lucky guy. Everyone in the band liked him. Anyway, the night we're talking about, the place was crowded and Ken came in early. Usually he came to work a bit later, but this night he came in about half hour early and the place was just warming up. Things were really getting going, people happy. Dance floor was crowded. I think it was a bit after 9 o'clock when we got on the stand. Anyway, we were playing for a while and then Ken said, "Let's do Oh Johnny." So anyway, we got into the number and it was round about the second chorus. I heard this like smash. I thought someone had thrown a bottle in my face. I saw this big blue flash and everything in the air. I grabbed my trumpet and got off the stand. Somebody showed me the way out. Everyone seemed to be asking, "What's happened? What's happening? What's happening down here?" "I don't know, man," I says. "I've just come up here." I was covered with dust. Anyway, I went off to play cards, so nothing had happened. Of course, all the time, I was really worried about Ken Johnson. Ken was the best man at my wedding. I was really worried about York D'Souza, too. He lived near me. Anyway, a man came up and he says to me, "You heard anything about Mr. Johnson?" I said, "No, I haven't heard anything." And this lady came up and she said, "You haven't seen Mr. Johnson?" I said, "No, I ain't seen him." She says, "Well, you're here, you're here." And I was told the news. Kenny wasn't with us anymore. So I went off to this nightclub and got my trumpet out and had a blow, just to get things right in my head. I know some people might think it wasn't the best thing to do, but what else could I do, you know what I mean? I thought it was the best thing to do. Anyway, I had a blow, and a long walk home to where I was living in Camden Town.
How could the safest night spot in London be bombed? Hidden away under the Rialto Cinema, I would have thought that would have been totally impossible. But a strange fluke of fate caused that. A German bomber overhead dropped two bombs. Right, there were, mind I must admit, official facts were never available. The civil defence authorities of the city of Westminster don't even have the facts themselves now, and they haven't had them for years, and for the following reasons. An inquiry was held into the whole incident, and of the failures of the medical and the ambulance services, at very high levels too, Westminster had to send off the file dealing with this incident. It was never returned, and it never will be. It's been presumed lost, and I suspect for a very good reason. The German bomber dropped two bombs. They went through the roof of the cinema without exploding. Now, that's incredible for a start. The cinema was empty, so they went straight through the floor without exploding and into the Café de Paris itself. One of them hit the floor and burst open, and the other exploded. It didn't even hit the floor. It exploded somewhere between the ceiling of the café and the floor, about chest level. And the sad thing was, it killed Ken Snakehips Johnson. Due to government restrictions on giving any useful information to anyone in case the Germans picked it up, the actual reporting of the incident was delayed for days. And even then, the club name could not be mentioned. The sad thing was, it took ages for ambulance staff and civil defence workers to arrive. That caused a lot of problems, believe me. Jazz and swing music followers soon learned, the news passed very quickly, that Ken Johnson did not survive that raid. Singer Don Johnson with the band told me that his brother didn't die in the Café de Paris. He died in the ambulance on the way to hospital. It made him wonder, and me too, that if medical attention had reached the place in time, could he have been saved? Well, we can only speculate now. But also killed in the tragedy that night was Davy Williams, the man who played the tenor solos and played so well. Of course, a lot of the cafe's well-to-do dancing clientele perished. Others who survived included musicians, and they were seriously hurt too. Carl Barrow, the clarinet player, got a broken wrist. Joe Denise's leg, that's a guitarist, was smashed. The blast blew him into the kitchen doorway. Tommy Bromley's leg was fractured. York de Souza, well, he got a lot of glass in his eyes because the whole nightclub was surrounded by glass mirrors, and they just sort of were smashed as smithereens. Dave Wilkins escaped, and Leslie Driver Hutchinson, whom we've heard explaining what happened to him in his state of shock. But like I say, this news was held up. And held up for very good reason, because it was...